Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. Here's the situation, folks. We're a week into September. It's blazing hot outside thanks to an end of summer heat wave. I'm just gonna call it now. We've rounded the corner. We've passed the inflection point, folks. The safety's off and the tech news has begun firing on all cylinders like it's trying to mow down the semi-transparent figure of an escaping alien trophy hunter in a dense Central American jungle. You lose it here and you're in a world of hurt. But despite the sweltering humidity and overabundance of newsworthy topics, like Intel doing both very poorly and very well at CPU making, AMD announcing the Z2 Extreme for handheld devices, or GamersNexus lining up their final kill shot with a brutal investigative piece on EK water blocks. But we soldier on, cutting our way through the bush so we can identify our targets and dispatch them with gruesome efficiency, because we ain't got time to bleed. But we do have time for tech news.
Excellent.
Today's video is brought to you by the Corsair K65 Plus Wireless RGB Keyboard, featuring silky smooth pre-lubricated Corsair MLX red mechanical switches, two layers of sound dampening for softened typing acoustics, AES encrypted connectivity via low latency 2.4 GHz wireless, Bluetooth or USB wired, a multi-purpose rotary dial with function key combos and shortcut commands, resilient PBT dye sublimated keycaps, and of course, per-key RGB lighting effects, which are endlessly customizable in Corsair's IQ software. For more on the Corsair K65 Plus, click the sponsor link in the video description. We begin with a recap of the hour and 15 minute GamersNexus video that dropped with a resounding thud on Friday, titled, How Four People Destroyed a $250 Million Tech Company, with Steve and team delivering on their promise to reopen the can of worms that is EK Waterblocks, a story that they first broke back in April, but it was distracted from by other industry tomfoolery from the likes of Asus and Intel. But Steve brought receipts, as well as ex-employee interviews, secretly recorded executive meetings, and an excess of tongue-in-cheek exasperated sarcasm to the table as he outlined why EK, who continues to do business, likely has a short lifespan left as a viable water cooling parts manufacturer. Steve alleges that this is completely due to executive mismanagement, with blame placed on the four people referenced in the title. EK's founder and namesake, Edward Koenig, co-CEO Marko Mitrovic, EK America's CEO Kat Silberstein, and former CEO and part owner Matches Kirch. The downward slide began back in 2018 after former CEO Mark Tenko left the company and leadership was taken over by Koenig and Kirch. Cash on hand and profit declined while liabilities increased drastically that year, but it took several years for issues to get worse, and their current liquidity troubles were temporarily put off by the PC industry as a whole, getting a sales boost in the year or two after COVID. However, it now seems that EK is in a death spiral of needing money to pay overdue contracts so it can stay in business, which necessitates taking out higher interest rate loans in a loan death loop, as GN describes it. The true scandal revolves around EK employees, however, who still haven't been getting paid in a timely fashion, sometimes going 2 to 3 months without a check per multiple former employees. Steve interviewed the soft-spoken and demure Dave Alcock, former EK marketing and PR rep, about how lack of pay influenced his ability to pay his mortgage, causing a hit to his credit that cost him thousands of Great British pounds. And former product designer and engineer Joe Roby corroborated that EK was postponing employee checks through May, well after the original allegations came out, and 40 plus other former employees couldn't go on record as they're preparing joint legal action against EK, so they need to stay off record for now. And that's like the first half of this video. The second half details all the ways EK management, and those four individuals in particular, contributed to EK's erosion by initiating poorly managed ego-driven projects that lost tens of thousands of dollars, or by setting up lucrative third-party contracts that paid tens of thousands of dollars to other businesses for dubious ROI, with many of those other companies just happening to have direct ties to EK's four bad execs or their close friends. Those big contracts often got paid out even as EK was failing to pay its direct employees as well. And then in recent months, as more of this internal corrosion has come to light, Edward and his cohorts have routinely attempted to silence criticism with unfounded threats of legal action towards former employees and media. So to sum up, good job, excellent job, GamersNexus, for going hard at this and continuing to set the standard for this type of investigative journalism on YouTube and the internet in general. And thanks for also ending on the positive note that Joe and Dave have found better jobs elsewhere. We sincerely hope for positive outcomes for all the employees and industry partners who have been negatively affected by the alleged shitty actions of the people who are supposed to be protecting them and their business. Wow, okay, so there's still a lot to cover today, so we're gonna be doing the rest of the show tech briefs style, starting with Intel. You want the Intel good news or the Intel bad news first? I prefer to get the bad news out of the way, and so would CEO Pat Gelsinger, who has been struggling in the past couple months to wrangle his out-of-control chip manufacturing business back into the corral of profitability and success. Pat's latest plan is to come up with a plan, and they will be discussing that plan in mid-September at a meeting, which sounds like a super corporately efficient way to make some changes to me. Intel might consider selling off Altera, the FPGA company they acquired in 2015, or pausing or halting construction on the $32 billion chip plant that they're currently building in Magdeburg, Germany. One proposal that apparently won't be on the table, though, is spinning off their fab business entirely. Pat loves his fabs, and you can hardly blame him. Speaking of fabs though, more bad news. Intel's 20A process is canceled, and their upcoming Arrow Lake chips will be produced by a competing chip fabricator that everyone is assuming is TSMC because realistically they're the only ones who could handle it. This was revealed in an Intel newsroom post on Wednesday, and it sounds pretty embarrassing for Team Blue, but they'd prefer we focus on the positive. They're canceling 20A because they want to move straight to 18A, where they are apparently having a good amount of success. So let's switch to good Intel news with reports that the 18 angstrom or 1.8 nanometer class manufacturing process that Intel is working on is healthy and producing wafers with a defect density of 0.4 per square centimeter, which is better than the accepted industry standard at this point in the development cycle. Defect density typically improves once a chip enters mass production as well, which is expected in mid-2025 for 18A, with the first CPUs to be manufactured on this node to be part of the Panther Lake family, successor to Lunar Lake, powering laptops that should launch in late 2025. Intel also has contracts lined up with Microsoft and the US Department of Defense to produce chips on 18A. Speaking of Lunar Lake, that series of mobile CPUs was officially announced by Intel on Tuesday, and continuing the good news trend, they are reportedly, according to Intel, better at CPU and GPU compute tasks as well as AI versus AMD and Qualcomm chips, also providing better battery life. If that sounds too good to be true, remember that these are Intel's numbers, so maybe they are. But you will likely be able to reference some independent reviews to verify or debunk these charts on or just before September 24th, when Lunar Lake laptops officially go up for sale. They'll ship out in Core Ultra 5 through Core Ultra 9 trim, with all CPUs having 4 P-cores, 4 E-cores, and 8 threads. So yep, no more hyper-threading. What a time to be alive. Moving on from Intel, we have some AMD news. They have announced the Z2 Extreme mobile APU at the IFA 2024 event in Berlin, based on Strix Point architecture, which will succeed the Z1 Extreme and power the next generation of handheld gaming devices, a la the Steam Deck or Asus ROG Ally. Most notably, the Z2E will supposedly extend playtime on battery from about 45 minutes to 3 hours, and specs-wise, it features 12 Zen 5 cores, 4 Zen 5 and 8 Zen 5C, as well as a 16 compute unit RDNA 3.5 based iGPU. It's likely to be featured in the Asus ROG Ally 2 and the Lenovo Legion Go 2 initially, and those devices are currently rumored to be unveiled at CES 2025 in January. AMD's current best CPU for gaming is the 7800X3D, but per Der Bauer's video from earlier this week, there are some convincing fakes that have made their way onto the market. The fake that Roman got his hands on was remarkably well made, and even included fake capacitors and a heat spreader with milled out protrusions to imitate the CPU and I/O die. The most noticeable difference was the bluish PCB versus the classic green of Ryzen CPUs and misaligned printing of the Ryzen logo and part number. A Reddit user also posted images of a clearly fake 7800X3D, the made in China printing gives it away, to say nothing of the misaligned socket. It's unlikely that fakes like these are being too widely produced given the level of detail and effort involved, but it's something to consider if your newly bought processor looks a bit off. Even a legit seller might have a CPU return come back that had a fake inserted into it that makes it pass their inspection process and gets relisted for sale as a new product. Last week, we confirmed that the 7600X3D would disappointingly be a Micro Center exclusive here in the US, but there is a follow-up. Rejoice with us, EU citizens, because you will also apparently have access to the 7600X3D via German retailer Mindfactory. It will be 330 euros, yes, which isn't the most competitive, but it is still well under what a 7800X3D is going for over there. And yes, we now have some benchmarks, courtesy of PCGamesHardware.de, which shows that across a 9-game test suite, the 7600X3D is a bit faster than the 9700X or the 7900X3D, but it still has a hard time keeping up with the 7800X3D, 7950X3D, or six other 13th and 14th gen K-SKU Intel CPUs. So perhaps that lack of availability isn't that huge of a deal after all. Speaking of things that aren't a big deal, NVIDIA was subpoenaed by the US Department of Justice this week. Dun dun dun! Except they weren't. Supposedly, on Tuesday, the subpoenas were sent, part of an escalating antitrust probe, as reported by Bloomberg and other agencies. But on Wednesday, NVIDIA was like, what subpoenas? They hit up the DOJ, and the DOJ said, we didn't subpoena you. And so it was all just a big misunderstanding, or a blatant attempt to manipulate stock prices. Who knows? Remember when our GPU manufacturers used to just manufacture gaming GPUs and weren't subjected to outside influence like crypto mining shortages or stock manipulation tactics? Pepperidge Farm remembers. Oh yeah, and AI, that other thing that is influencing GPU pricing and availability, saw a bombshell report from Windows Central on Tuesday that 57% of online content is AI generated. I knew it. Except that was actually a gross misrepresentation of a Forbes article that said 57% of web-based text is AI generated. I mean, I translated. 57% of web-based text is machine translated. And Forbes said, likely. The low quality of this content indicates it was likely machine translated, which seems less pinpoint accurate than that 57% value implies. And even that Forbes article references a Nature.com article that doesn't talk about that 57% value anywhere. I'm starting to think that all of the intelligence I see online must be artificial. And if I may bookend this video with another Predator reference, it's time to get old Painless out the bag. Not really related, I just like that line. But there you have it, guys, tech news for the week. And if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all of the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested, and you can check out my store at paulshardware.net for high quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. I've got some new stuff coming in real soon, so get subscribed to my channel. That's always a good call too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.